After this tutorial, the goal is that you like kind of understand PyTorch, like you know how it works basically. You understand all the concepts of PyTorch. There aren't too many. They are pretty simple, I think. And we're going to do a little transfer learning tutorial because transfer learning is what you do or quite often. Like 90% of the cases you can use transfer learning and get good results for computer vision problems, I think. Like it's really rare that I design a network from scratch. I normally have a pre-trained backbone and then do stuff with it afterwards. Also, there are some nice tools and libraries that I'm going to show you that are handy. Quite often I have these like note to self because I'm using JupyterLab. It's the first time that I'm using JupyterLab for a presentation. I'm pretty excited about that. But I don't have speaker notes right now, so I have note to self scattered all over. Just ignore it. It's just for me. Yesterday I published this repository and I already got like three issues or like contributions, and thank you for that. I'm really stoked about that. You can follow along and type along if you want to, if you have already downloaded it. If you haven't done that, please don't. The internet is not great, I've heard. I don't know. I have instructions actually how you can set this up on Google Colab. Do you know Google Colab? Who knows Google Colab? Some, right? It's basically like a IPython notebook environment on the in the cloud, in Google's cloud, and you can get a GPU for free, which is amazing. And yeah, if we had internet, you could go there, enable the GPU, and pip install PyTorch, or Torch and Torch Vision, and you have everything you need, basically. But because the internet is not that great, sadly, we can't do that. But if you want to play with a GPU and you don't have one at home, try it out. So this is what we're going to talk about. We will cover some basics, and the basics of machine learning are tensors. We're going to briefly talk about autograd, or like automatic differentiation, and then we're going to go into debugging in PyTorch, which is amazing. We're going to cover some more advanced, I wouldn't say, like some more concepts, which are data sets, data loaders, samplers, and transforms, which are just like a nice abstraction to get work done, basically. And then in the last step, we are going to do transfer learning and visualize everything and use some other libraries. So that is the main part of the talk. And then I have lots of little different things that are kind of PyTorch and that are cool, but I don't know if I can fit them in here, so I have them separately. And in the end, if we have time and if you want to do it, we can look at some, which are like quite cool. If we don't have time, we can't do it. But look at it at home. There's some cool stuff in there, I think. PyTorch overview. So this is what pretty much every presentation about PyTorch contains. Like, this is PyTorch. This is how it works. This is amazing. And the first time I saw it, I was like, okay, great. They you know, create some variables, 1, 2, 3 variables, and they multiply it, then they add it, then they have a tangent, and then they do back propagation. Okay, great. But why is this so great? Like, and the idea is that, like, this computational graph is built up as you execute it, as opposed to TensorFlow, where you define your graph and then you run it. Here, you like create your graph by running it. That's a big difference. But I still don't think this really captures what PyTorch can do. What is much cooler is this. So here I have, like, I import Torch, I have a little function which gets an argument x, which then it multiplies x by x, you get a result. And this thing, this is the magic. You can use a debugger in PyTorch. And the people, some people who have used TensorFlow a lot, they can't do that, really. I mean, TensorFlow is changing, and they have eager execution mode, but this, when PyTorch came out, it was like, oh, you can use a debugger. That's crazy. And you're so used to using a debugger, basically, but you can't do that really in TensorFlow. So this is amazing. And yeah, then you're in the debugger here, and you can get values just by looking at it. It's like it's just Python. It's nothing else. You don't need a special tensor board plugin to debug or anything. It's just there. And if you like really build up networks from scratch, just being able to look at it, look at your gradients, look at your values without even thinking about it, it makes life so much easier, I think. So this is personally the main reason why I like it so much. We're going to go more into debugging later. It's just like a, you know, little teaser. I like PyTorch because it's just stupid Python. I don't have to think about it. Like, I'm just doing Python. That's it, really. It's easy to debug. I already showed you can do it. It has a few classes which are very nice interfaces, simple interfaces, which I immediately understand. I don't have to think about it. It's not a complicated API. And quite a lot of research is published in PyTorch. So if you like reading papers and stuff, quite often there's a PyTorch implementation to it. And if there's only a TensorFlow implementation, you just wait a week and then there's a PyTorch implementation. I'm not saying that PyTorch is the best deep learning library. Like, there are so many out there. It's really like a tyranny of choice. There are really great deep learning libraries out there. Just 5 years ago or something, or 4 years, or 3 years maybe even, that wasn't the case. So you probably know TensorFlow. TensorFlow is a big one, and it's great if you want to productionize your stuff. TensorFlow Serving is great. They have TensorFlow Transform now. Like, it's a Google product. There's lots of momentum with it. Like, it's great. I've heard great things about MXNet. It's also like a dynamic library like PyTorch. And Keras just gives you like a great interface, like a high-level interface to your deep learning library. So if you just get started, look at Keras, I would say. But if you want to play around, like PyTorch, really, it's fun, I think. If you look at this later, there are lots of references. The Twitter feed is quite the PyTorch Twitter feed is nice. You get like lots of researchy things, lots of cool features, lots of new libraries. Just look at it. PyTorch is also available for like Torch Vision, which does like the computer vision part of PyTorch. You have the same for text and for audio. And you have a few cool courses. Like, there's the Fast AI course, which is a lot of fun. They do cool things, and I copied a bit of that. There's the Stanford CS230, which is also a great course. And also the official documentation of PyTorch is great. They have lots of examples. They have lots of tutorials. Just do them. Like, there's so much stuff in there, probably more than in here. But people at a conference are there to learn something, so I'm just, you know, giving them some sugar so that I can get started. Good. Almost done with the intro. We're going to start with tensors, like with a very low-level thing, and then we're building up stuff. Just to give you an idea how the network in the end looks like, here we have two networks. So these are the standard imports. Import Torch, basically, because you need some Torch stuff. You import Torch NN, that's the neural network package of PyTorch. And you have a functional interface, which is very similar to the NN, but functional. Like, you don't have any parameters in there. Details, we can talk about it later. So let's define a simple network, just to get a feeling for it. What you can do, you have this NN sequential. And NN sequential is basically just a list or order dict or something of layers. Layers like, here I use the order dict because I wanted to give it names. And I can say I have a layer which is called conf1. And it's a conf2d layer which has one input channel, 20 output channel, and a kernel size of 5. Then I have a ReLU layer. Then I have a conf2d layer. Again, this is exactly like above. I just left out the keywords. Then I have a ReLU layer. And then I pack that into a sequential. And now I have a simple neural network. Very similar to Keras from this point of view, I think. Or if you want to build a little bit more a complicated model, or like what PyTorch recommends doing, you create a class. You inherit from NN module. Then, of course, it's a class. You write like your init function. You have super, like you call the constructor of your parent class. And then we're just saying here that we have a bunch of layers, basically, and we just save them as member variables of the class. And then you have to define a forward function. And the forward function basically gets some data, in this case x, and passes the data x through the conf layer, through the ReLU, to a pool, and you get some output. And then you keep going, basically. So here you can just define how your data flows through your graph. And you can have like multiple ways and stuff. Like, you can just be crazy. It's just Python. You know, you could have loops. You could have for loops. You could have ifs in here if you want to, which is also like, what? This is crazy. And you also, like, you always get the automatic differentiation. Like, you don't have to think about the gradients. Again, it's like, it's amazing. So this is where we're going. But we're going to start very small with little tensors, right? So PyTorch basic tensors autograd. Who is following along with the code? Just OK, cool. I encourage you to ask questions. If you have problems, if I'm too fast, normally I'm too fast in the beginning. Like, I need to burn some speed, then everything is good. OK, basics. Again, here we have our basic import. These three things you should always have. Whoops. You should always have as your input. And then I have some more input for matplotlib and whatnot, not really that interesting. Sorry, my monitor is not really moving with the slides. Oh well. The best thing about PyTorch and the tensors are that they're almost exactly like NumPy tensors. And we've all used NumPy tensors. It's, you know, just some data, some array data, really. So in NumPy, you can just create like an identity matrix by saying npi. And you get an identity matrix. You can do the same with Torch. And you get a tensor. But the result is pretty much the same. So the interface is pretty much the same. You can, in NumPy, create like a random matrix, or a random tensor, random array, just by saying np random.random. And you can do pretty much the same with PyTorch. Here it's called rand. Sorry. Yes. Okay, so a tensor, like, you can have a scalar, which is just one value. You can have a vector, which is like a bunch of values. You can have a matrix, which are two-dimensional things. And a tensor is a generalization of that. You can have like 3 dimensions, 4 dimensions, 5 dimensions. You can't really picture it anymore, but that's how it looks like, basically. Just pretend you can. Everybody does it. Yeah. So just a bunch of numbers in some kind of shape. That's really it. With this x here, this was... Oh, my screen is smaller. Now I see. OK. This x was the NumPy thing, and you can get the shape. You can do the same with... Yes. 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 Oh, the question... Is it like a multi-dimensional array? Yes, it is. Yeah.
It's just a mathematical term, I guess.
I guess. Yeah. Thank you. Just a mathematical term for a multi-dimensional array. Okay. So again, the interface is the same. In NumPy, we can use matrix multiplication. Here we do x transpose times. Well, matrix multiply x. By the way, this is possible now with, I don't know, Python 3, 4 or something. You use Python 3, that's what I'm saying. And you can do the same with Torch. Here it's not a capital T, here it's a small t, but you transpose the matrix or the tensor and you multiply it. Cool. What you can also do, you can do your typical linear algebra, like you can take a matrix inverse. Here we take the inverse of the product of x transpose and x, and that works. And again, torch, pretty similar. Here it's called inverse. Oh well. And if you did like a basic machine learning course, like you can solve everything with tensors. Like I'm biased, I'm a data scientist, machine learner. Like you can solve everything with tensors. That's just the way it is. PyTorch has some, I don't know, additional things. Like most of the operators are also available as functions. Like you can say at, for example, instead of writing a plus. Nothing big. And this is a little bit odd, I think, but it's quite handy when you get used to it. You have the functions with an underscore, which does an in-place operation. That's it, really. You have the same for subtract, multiply, blah, 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 all these things. Like, if you have an underscore, it's an in-place operation. And NumPy is great because you have all these, like, crazy broadcasting tricks. Like, you can add, like, a small matrix to a big matrix, and if certain conditions of the shape are satisfied, that's just automated, like, automatically broadcasted. And you can access stuff, right? So A looks like this, and I can get the very first element up here by doing this. Not very surprising. Or I can get the row, or I can specify like a slice or any crazy thing. Like all that stuff that you can do with NumPy, it works with Torch. They really extended that, I think, in the previous version a lot. Before it was kind of limited, but now it's almost there where NumPy is. Another very, very nice thing is, NumPy and SciPy, that's a huge ecosystem, and they all use NumPy arrays, right? So PyTorch makes it really easy to convert from NumPy and to PyTorch tensors to NumPy. So here we have a torch tensor, and then we just turn it into a NumPy tensor. Great. Awesome. So we can still leverage all this great ecosystem that we're living in by just writing .numpy, and we're good to go. And the same works the other way around. So if we have a NumPy array, we can turn it into a torch tensor by saying torch from NumPy. That's really it. And this is very basic, but it's already pretty powerful, I think. Any questions so far? Yes. If I understand you correctly, you're saying, why do we need a new tensor? Why can't we just reuse NumPy, basically? Great question. And the answer is basically the next section. We can calculate the derivatives, or NumPy allows, or automatically calculates the derivatives of certain matrix operations. That means, so there's this package called AutoGrad in Torch, and that calculates derivatives for you, and you use the derivatives normally to optimize some cost function. You can do many things with it, but that's the gist of it, really. For example, so here we create a tensor W, which each tensor has this requires grad, which tells you if you're going to record the gradient. And by default, it's true. By default, it's false. Sorry. And we create a second tensor Z, and then we do some operation. W plus Z is total. Great. And now we could calculate the gradients. What do you think is going to happen here? Nothing. It's a runtime error. Because if we want to do that, like if we want to do this calculation and calculate the gradients, we have to say requires grad equals true. And when we do that, then requires grad is equal to true, which is great. And then we can use backward. And we get the gradient. So why do we need this new type of tensor? Because this new type of tensor automatically tracks all the calculations that we do and spins off this this graph of computation. And that allows us to get the gradients, which is amazing. So if you did like a machine learning class back then and you had to like manually calculate the derivatives and whatnot and you always got it wrong, like me, this is your friend. And by now, this is standard. Like TensorFlow does it, Theano does it. Like all the tools give you automatic differentiation. You don't really think about it anymore. It's just the way how you optimize your cost function in the end. You automatically use the gradients. That's really it. The interface of PyTorch changed a little bit with the last version, 0.4, and now you have this context manager. You can say with Torch, no gradients, and then you can do a calculation. And all the calculations that happen in this context, they don't track the gradients. So you do that if you have some calculation, then you know I don't need the gradients because I'm just in the evaluation phase or something. I'm not interested in gradients. Then use this context manager. You can do many, 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 many things with the autograd, but it's all hidden away. Like, it's really rare that nowadays I import this. The tensor automatically tracks the gradients for you. Before 4.0, you had a special class called variable, and if you wanted to record gradients, you had to wrap the tensor into a variable, and then you tracked the gradients. And the variable behaved exactly like a tensor, but tracked gradients. So if you see tutorials online, and there are lots of them, and they use variables, this is the old version of PyTorch. You don't need that anymore. Just requires grad equals true, and you're good to go. Another reason why we use PyTorch tensors, because PyTorch like advertises itself as very GPU friendly. And we can just move tensors to the GPU or data to the GPU. All the calculation then automatically happens on the GPU. And that's great. So what you do, that also changed with version 0.4. This is a recommended way of doing it. You basically define this variable called device, and you ask Torch if CUDA is available. And if CUDA is available, then you set the string, or you could set it to, if you had two GPUs, you could set it to one, or two, or three, or how many you have, right? Otherwise, it's the device is set to CPU. So if I execute this, I sadly only get device type equals CPU. Because I don't have a GPU. If you have a GPU, you have CUDA 1 there, basically. And then, now I know that I have a GPU, or I don't. And I can just, I assume, let's pretend I have a GPU. If I do this, so here I create some data, it's an identity tensor, and then I say data to device. If this was a GPU, I would just move it to the GPU. If I then would add this data to itself, this calculation would automatically happen on the GPU. So if I calculate, like, you can use this to basically write down any algorithm which uses tensors or whatnot, and then just say to GPU, and the algorithm runs on the GPU, which is also like, wow, this is amazing. You know, it's not just neural networks, so you can really do anything on the GPU just by two GPU, which is cool. Sometimes you have to think about it, how many, I don't know, CUDA cores are started or tensor cores or what. Like, it's not automatically faster, but quite often you can get very nice speed ups. Great question. Do you need to install cuDNN and CUDA if you use PyTorch, is a question. And the answer is yes, but if you do conda install torch, you automatically get cuDNN and CUDA installed, which is normally like a hassle to install, right? And there you just do it, and good to go. I have cuDNN, I have CUDA, which is amazing. Yeah. That was actually one of the reasons why I switched to PyTorch, because it just worked. You know, don't have to download anything, don't have to register on NVIDIA or something. No, it doesn't. If you use conda install torch, it puts the CUDA library somewhere in the Anaconda path, and your old stuff is still there. But if you work with it in the conda environment, everything is good. So it's amazing. But the thing you have to download, like the conda install torch, is pretty big, because you get all the libraries. Downside, you know, ups and downs. Cool. Oh yeah, right. Before 0.4. You normally defined like a CUDA, like you checked if CUDA is available, and then you had this variable, and then you had lots of if CUDA model dot CUDA, and there you basically moved it to the GPU. But now you have this two device, and you don't have to make the if else statement. I think it's a little bit nicer, no big thing though. Oh, another advantage of this is you can specifically say that some operations should happen on the GPU, and some shouldn't. Like, if you know that moving the data to the GPU has a huge overhead, and it's not really worth it for the calculation, then you don't need to do it. And you can just test it and see if it makes sense to move certain computation to the GPU or keep it on your CPU. Also pretty amazing. OK, so that was the basic stuff. Like, we have tensor, we have tensors, we have automatic differentiation to get gradients, and we can move it to the GPU, which is pretty powerful already, I think. And now I do a very simple linear regression with PyTorch, and I'm going to use optimizer and gradient descent. And I would do it on GPU if I had a GPU, but it also works on the CPU. So here I use scikit-learn. Oh, I use scikit-learn. I use NumPy again. Like, I can use all the stuff that I had before, which is nice, and create some data x and y. I'll just plot it for you. And it looks like this. Very simple. One-dimensional data and one-dimensional output. There's a question. So the question, how do you use multiple GPUs? And sadly or luckily, I'm not in the position that I have to do that. I would like to play around with it, but you know, you can do it. Like, you can have like data parallel stuff, and then things are calculated on different GPUs. Like, PyTorch can handle it, and it's quite efficient up to a certain number of GPUs. But I can't give you any practical details. It's possible, yeah. OK, back to linear regression. That's where we're all here for, right? So we have some data, x and y. X is here, y is here. Now we want to work with PyTorch, right? So what do? We already learned that. Torch from NumPy, I put the data in there, I make sure that's a float tensor. And I do the same with my Y, my labels, and I'm just reshaping it because I want a certain shape. Okay, great. And now, linear regression with PyTorch. Complete overkill. So I write a class, how you do it in PyTorch. I inherit from the NN module. I call the super method. And then I have a parameter, which I call beta, which is just like a linear layer, which gets input dim as input, which is one input dimension. And I have one output dimension. And then I have the most boring forward function ever. The forward function gets data, passes it through our linear layer, and returns the result. Very, very boring. Here you can see that there's automatically like a bias added. I could remove that if I wanted to, but I leave it here because I think it makes sense. Oh yeah, also I think the PyTorch documentation and the docstrings are actually like okay, which is more than I would say for many libraries. Okay, now I have my data, I have my linear regression model. If I want to do it on the GPU, I again define my device variable, which has like CUDA or CPU in it. And then, like every machine learning model, you have a loss, and you have an optimizer. Model, loss, optimizer, always the same. Or model, optimizer, loss in this case. This is the interesting part here. To device, I move my model to the GPU. Now all the calculations are going to happen on the GPU. And I also move my data to the GPU. Maybe this as well. PyTorch, of course, offers a wide variety of optimizers. You have your standard, like your vanilla stochastic gradient descent. You have ADAM. You have ADAGRAD. You have like all of them, pretty much. Not all of them, but lots of them. I'm also not going to give you a recommendation which optimizer you should use. I just want to like explain that it's there. In the NN module, you also have a bunch of losses. Here I'm using the mean squared error because it's a linear regression problem, and why not, right? So, okay, now I have my model, my loss, my optimizer. And now I'm writing a training loop. If you know, there's a question. Why do I move the model to the GPU? Because the model has parameters, and the parameters should be on the GPU so that they're optimized on the GPU. And I need the data on the GPU because all the calculations should happen on the GPU. So if data and model parameters are on the GPU, everything happens on the GPU. If I don't do that, you have like data on the GPU and some data on the CPU. That doesn't work like that. Good question. Yes? In this case, I think it would give you an error message. Like there's operation and it gets GPU data and the CPU data, and then just tells you this is probably not what you want to do. Here's an error. Yeah. But if you do this and for some reason your device isn't really recognized, I just found that out when my workstation goes in suspend mode and wakes up again. It doesn't recognize the GPU anymore. And all of a sudden, my training was 20 times slower. Like, that can happen. So you could have, like, you could make sure that you... I shouldn't type, I guess. All okay? Yeah. You could do something like that to prevent that. This wouldn't work, not quite like this, but just make sure that you get the GPU to avoid these problems, basically. Okay, back to this. So we have our model, we have our optimizer, we have our loss function, and now we have to do a training loop. And this is a thing that I don't really like about PyTorch. If you use Keras or something, you can just say fit and say 10 epochs or whatever, and just fits it. That is nice. Here, PyTorch, you have to do it yourself. And that's not nice. So what do you do? First of all, maybe one of the biggest mistakes, you have to set your model in the train mode. You have the train mode and you have the eval mode. And a train mode, for example, if you use dropout, dropout is only available or like active in the train mode. Basically, you have your strong neural network and then you like hold one arm behind the back, so can only use one arm. That is train mode. And then in eval mode, you have both hands and it's like much stronger, basically. So don't forget that. Ooh, you didn't see that. You have to say optimizer zero grad, which basically nulls your gradient, because otherwise they would accumulate. So in each step, you have to set your gradients of the optimizer to zero. And then we pass the data through the data X through our model, and we get our prediction. Earlier, I defined my mean squared error here, and PyTorch calculates the loss. Now we pass the data through our model, calculated the loss. This was a forward pass. Now we do the backward pass, and we say loss dot backward loss. And then optimizer step optimizes or updates the parameters of our linear regression model. Then we go into the eval mode. Here, very important. And we pass the data through our model and get some predictions. And here I'm saying, oh, I'm not interested in the gradients. I should have split the data in training set and validation set. I didn't do that here. You should do that. Just think, this data down here, this is a validation data, right? I'm sorry I didn't do that. I actually feel bad now. And then afterwards, I'm plotting the data just to, you know, see what happens. Okay, oh, this is already too good. Oh well. This was one iteration, right? And I turned the learning rate like pretty much to zero because I wanted to do a few steps. So here you can see our the blue one is our prediction, and the orange one, I guess, is the data. And now I'll just do a few. Oh, maybe. Sorry. So here we go. Do it again. Like the learning rate was too big, right? And then instead of doing like a gradient descent, you do something like this and all over the place, right? So what did I do? I turned on the learning rate. Oh, now that we're here, this is also interesting, right? I have my stochastic gradient descent and I have to pass the parameters of the model. I could only also pass like a part of the parameter of the model if I want to, so that I only optimize like part of the model. Or I could use different parts of the model and have different learning rates. You can also do that with PyTorch, which is very, very nice. Not showing that. Okay, maybe this is better. Yeah, this is better. The loss, just wait, the loss is decreasing, right? 970, 960. We'll get there. I mean, this is machine learning, right? You get the feeling, right? It's getting smaller. 550, 500, 400, yeah. I have like more machine learning 101 in a different notebook, which I'm not going to show you. But if you want to like do everything from scratch, here is in files. Here is machine learning 101, I think, at home. If you want to look at it, It's a lot of fun, I think. It just has lots of these goofy animations. Yeah. Okay. There was like a little linear regression model, and you saw how everything works. Like you have your model, you have your loss, you have your optimizer. You have to write your training loop, which is not ideal, and we talk about that later. Yes. Say that again. Yeah. Oh, I did that on purpose so that I can show you how the model learns. Is there any way to automate that? Yes, of course. You put it in a for loop and you're done. Yeah. It's PyTorch. You can. It's nuts. Yeah. Or you can, like, every second iterate. Oh, sorry. Can you modify your model during training? And yes, you can, because it's PyTorch. You could keep what you have, add something else. You could also do something crazy, like in every second epoch, you have a different path. Like you have your base layer, and then you split, if it's like an even number or uneven number, you train different parts of the networks. Like, why would you do that? I don't know, but you can. Okay, ooh, I have to hurry. Debugging. This is the best part of Python. So I asked a friend, no debugger for your code, what do you think? And she said, like, I wouldn't be able to code. Like, but this is kind of the state we are in with TensorFlow. You can't really use the normal debugger. Like, it's getting better, it's getting better. But yeah, it's kind of weird. So who does printline debugging here? Come on, everybody. I don't believe you. And I think that's totally fine. Like, if you have a problem, quite often you just need a print, and this is wrong, of course. And this is maybe like 90% of the cases, maybe 95, right? Who uses TensorFlow here? Who likes, or what is the overlap of the people who do or like printline debugging and who like TensorFlow? I think it's zero. Yes. So Python has this debugger PDB or the IPDB, the IPython debugger. It's very handy. If you don't use it that often, play around with it. Like, you really improve your coding a lot, and you'll solve issues much faster, I think. Here's a little cheat sheet. I'm not going into that because I have to hurry a little bit. But what you can do is basically, here I'm importing the setTrace function. And then I have a function here, and I have a setTrace in here. And now in my function, I can just look at variables. For example, at answer. I could say next. And then I could look at x, or I could look at answer. Oops. And I get the values. And quite often, this is all you really need. Like, print is great, but if you need some more context, where are you, or need to do some arithmetic, or some math, some compare two things, just use a debugger. Right? And you can do that in neural networks. Like, PyTorch modules are just Python. So here I create some data x. And I create a module, which again inherits from an NN module. I have a linear layer, three input, one output. I have a forward function. I pass in some data. I pass the data through the linear function, and I get the result. And if I do these things, I quite often, the first thing I do is I think about the dimensionality. Like, what do I put in? What do I get out? And in this case, I know this was 5 times 3. I put that in here. This is 3 times 1. This is what I should get out. And quite often, then I actually write an assert just to make sure that this is really what I want, right? And if I do that, I get an assertion error. I got 5, like a tensor with a shape 5.3, but this is not what I wanted. So what do I do? I can set a trace. Now I'm in the debugger. I see where I am here, right? I can look at X. This is what I expected from X. That's all there is, so I execute the next line. Okay, maybe I can look at the locals. And then, ooh, this is weird. I have a X here, and I have a small X here. So maybe I just made a stupid typo, right? Maybe that's all it is. And I look at it, and here's a capital X, here's a capital X, here's a small X. There's a capital X. I want to return this. Exit, and I'm done. And now if I test it again, or test, I mean, if I execute it again, and remove the trace, of course, because I don't need that anymore, it works. And this is so amazing, I think. Like, doing that with TensorFlow, whew. Okay. Oh, I can't scroll further down here. Okay. Recap. What have we learned? We have tensors. It's nice, right? We get automatic derivatives. We can put everything on the GPU. And we have this NN module, which allows us to define our networks. And you have to write this forward function. That's all you have to do, really. And set trace works amazing. Questions so far? Yes.
Sure. You're getting a lot out of it because it's all Python.
Yes.
What about its performance? If you compare that with TensorFlow.
What about it? They're almost the same speed. Oh, what is the performance? I mean, it's nice that it's Python, but how is the performance compared to, for example, TensorFlow? And TensorFlow computes this graph and can do like a bunch of optimization. So in theory, it should be much, much faster. They're pretty much about the same speed, I would say. For the most things I've done, they're pretty much the same speed. And all the calculation then actually happens on the GPU. So pretty much about the same speed. MXNet, I've seen some nice results where they like sometimes are much faster than TensorFlow or PyTorch. But yeah, about the same. Yeah, I think, what about memory consumption? I think it's TensorFlow is a little bit better. Depends on, but same ballpark. How good is TensorFlow, PyTorch with like serializing data, serializing your model? And this is not, yeah. So also one of the things I don't really like about PyTorch. Like if you have a TensorFlow model, you define your graph, it's defined, you can write it to disk, you're done. PyTorch is much more dynamic and you can have ifs and random numbers in your forward loop. And that is like, it's hard to serialize. You can serialize your model and if you have a simple model that works quite well. But I prefer TensorFlow there. There is a new project called Onyx, which I think is from Microsoft and Facebook. I might be wrong. And they basically define this format for exchanging computational graph or neural networks for our case. And then you can, doesn't quite work yet, or works for simple cases, export your PyTorch model to Caffe, to TensorFlow, to whatever. And lots of stuff is happening there. I have much more on that later, maybe, if I have enough time. Okay, all the basics, except not quite. If you work with data, or if you work with machine learning, quite a big part, maybe the biggest part, is dealing with data, like ingesting it, transforming it, putting it in the right form and whatnot. And PyTorch gives you... That's big enough, right? Yeah. Gives you a nice few helper classes. There's the dataset class. There are transforms, and transforms, I'm talking about transforms for computer vision, like image augmentation and stuff. You have a data loader. You have an assembler. So, by the way, this is a nice feature of JupyterLab, I think. I really like that. So let's get to it. So PyTorch datasets are just simple classes which have an interface of a underscore underscore get item underscore underscore and length, like length, how many items are in there. And then the dataset allows you to get one element of your dataset. That's really it. And I have this dogs and cats dataset here. Right now it's loading the data. Loading data from data raw dogs cats sample train. The sample data set is not big. So what's downloaded looks like this. Like under data raw dogs and cats, I have a sample folder which contains train and valid and the two classes, cats and dogs. And I have like a big folder with train and validation, right? Quite often I have the sample folder just because it's much easier to work with small data and you get everything going and can test everything, make sure the dimensions are right and whatnot. And then afterwards you can switch to the full data set and you only have to change like one line of code, basically. Not quite that simple, but. Okay, so how does the data set look like? A data set looks like this. Well, this is what the dogs and cats data set is telling me. I have 16 data points because I'm working with the sample data, right, to make everything faster. It's saved here. And I have no transforms and no target transforms. We'll get to that later. And I said, you have to implement two functions if you write your own data set. And I really encourage you, just if you have a problem, write a simple data set. It's going to make everything so much easier than dealing with the pure tensors or files, reading files and stuff. This is a very nice little abstraction. So if I do lang, it tells me, oh, 16 data sets. I implemented get item. If I do get train data set 0, I get a tuple of a pill image, which is a certain size. And here, this is a label. So let's look at the image, or like one image. And here we go. Oh, right? Yeah. these two functions are really all that you have to implement, but quite often most functions have, most data sets have more like convenient functions. For example, you can get the classes, and you get the list of the classes or the name of the classes, like cats and dogs. Or you have a dictionary which maps from class name to ID. Or you have, in this case, you have an image list which has the list of all images and the corresponding class. Like just some convenient things, but you don't have to offer that. Right? And here we're just looking at all the images. Okay. Nice, right? So now we can get data. But quite often, if you do computer vision, you have to transform it. Like, for once, PyTorch doesn't want pillow images. It wants... tensors. Yeah. But also, if you do computer vision, you normally augment your data quite a bit. So, for example, maybe you want to have a random crop of your image. How does this look like? So here... Here we do a random crop of this dog. You get the idea, right? And quite often, you don't just want to do one transform, but you want to do multiple transforms. So here it's doing a horizontal flip sometimes. And PyTorch, you can like implement your little transform functions. It's again a very simple interface, and I think you have to implement the call method. I'm not quite sure about this one. And it also allows you to compose your transforms. So maybe you first want to do a flip and then a rotation, or maybe you want to do the other way around. Sometimes it just makes sense to have like all this power to compose your image augmentation pipeline. And if you think of Keras, Keras also offers like nice image augmentation, but it's very limited in what you can do. Like it offers you this like limited. I wouldn't say limited. You have these like 10 options or whatever, and you can just do it, but you can't rearrange them or something. You don't really have the granularity that you sometimes need. And having a compose function, which just gets an image, put it into the first one, puts it in the second one, etc., is quite nice, right? And yeah, PyTorch offers a lot of these. You also have random color jitter, which is nice. So, sorry. If you use this, your neural network generalizes much better. So, okay. And in the end, we're going to. So, we have a bunch of transformations here. Then we. Turn it into a tensor, and we also normalize it so that the data is normalized for the network and works better. And these are the standard value that PyTorch uses for the normalization. And now you don't get an image anymore, but you get a tensor. Okay. There are a few other image augmentation libraries which you can just plug into here. Like they have like crazy transforms and crazy stuff. ImageAug or Augmentor is pretty big. There are nice tutorials on image augmentation and transformations in the official PyTorch documentation. Pillow SIMD is, I think, 6 times faster than the simple Pillow, or it depends on the operations and whatnot. Like import or install Pillow SIMD. It's much faster. That's what I'm saying. Like some people complain about like Pillow is slow, and yes, it is. But with this, it's much faster. Just let you know. I don't have internet. Google just did like an architecture search for image augmentation. So now they have like. They searched over a bunch of strategies for how to do image augmentation, and generally it's pretty good. You know, it's state-of-the-art results and a bunch of things. Of course, there's a PyTorch implementation, as I said before, right? This Google project, there's a PyTorch implementation, and you can use it, and you get like great image augmentation, and you don't really have to think about it too much. So we have a data set. Main concept to get data, to get one data point. But quite often you want to get like a batch of data. And PyTorch has you covered there. It has the data loader, which basically gets a data set and can return batches of data. And it automatically gives you multiprocessing. So that, I don't know, each image or whatever is like calculated in parallel. And yeah, let's skip this. So basically what you do, you create a data loader, you pass it a data set. You can, for example, give it the batch size, and you can say, do I want to shuffle the data? With a train data set, it makes sense. With a validation data set, it doesn't really. You can give it the number of workers. I set it to 4. And then you can get an iterator of this training data loader, and you can just call the next function. So I'm just doing it here, and I think I wanted to show something here. Oh wait, I think I didn't execute. Did I? Right. What I wanted to say, if you create your data set, pass in the transforms. So the data loader expects tensors, and the data set just returned a pillow image, right? But my transforms did some transforms and then turned it into a tensor. So create your data set, pass in the transforms, create a data loader with the parameters you want, and then it works. Cool. And here you see I get a batch, and it consists of two images, has three dimensions for the color and the shape or size of 224 by 224. Plus my Y, which also has two, my labels, which just has like two labels, right? Because batch size 2. Cool. And now we can get one image. We can get a bunch of images, like a batch of images with a data loader. We have the transforms, which can transform stuff. But sometimes you actually want to have more control about how you get your data, like the strategy of how you get it. Maybe you want the dogs and the cats in the same relation. Like, you always want two dogs and two cats, and you don't want to train on four cats or something. Or if you have like a highly unbalanced data set where you have one positive example and 30,000 negative examples, maybe you want to change the ratio there, right? And there you have, and well, again, like PyTorch has you covered, you have samplers there. And samplers allow you to define how you get the samples. And you have a like sequential sampler, a random sampler, a subset sampler, a weighted random sampler, which is, for example, very good if you have like unbalanced data sets that you can do a bunch of stuff with. And again, it's a super simple interface. Just implement iter and return like index of what you want to access in your data set. That's it. So if you want to go, always start with the last data set that you have. Basically, return like a list of indices starting with the last one and then going backwards, for example. Yeah, here's an example for the subset random sampler. You have to implement the iter function. And here we return a generator, which basically just returns like a permutation of the indices, kind of. The details don't matter. You only have to implement the iter function, and you get the desired behavior, whichever you want. So what do we have? We have transforms, transforming the data, image augmentation, whatnot. We have data set, getting access to one sample, data loader, combining all that stuff to get batches of data, plus multiprocessing. And we have sampler if we really need more control about how we get each sample. Very nice. So before I used PyTorch, I used Keras a lot, and then I had some specific problems, and I pretty much like implemented all these classes for myself and the sampler, and I was pretty proud of myself. And then I switched to PyTorch, and I was like, man, this is so obvious, right? So I wanted you to do some coding, but I'm short on time already. If you do this at home, you could write your own little data set. It's very simple, and it's very satisfying, surprisingly. Cool. So now we have all the basics. Now we're going to do, finally, transfer learning and some nice tools. Questions so far? Not that I know of. Is there a best practice for serializing transformers? Normally, I just not that I know of. The answer. Normally, I have my transform compose thing, and I have the code for that, and then just reuse it in production. Yes. TensorFlow has now something that is called TensorFlow Transform, I think, which allows you to do like crazy transformation pipelines, which are then part of the computational graph. And that is super nice, I think. That is maybe your motivation, yes. That is very nice, yeah. Okay, transfer learning. So we have this dogs and cats data set. We have all these concepts. We have tensors, we have data sets, we have data loaders, we have transforms. And now we're going to combine it all and do some transfer learning. Who knows what transfer learning is? Okay, so transfer learning is machine learning. And you basically use a pre-trained network. So in this case, the network is going to be pre-trained on the image net data set. And then you freeze the entire network. And you have the last layer, which is just responsible for like classifying what's going on. Like you have all the features, and then you just classify to say this is a dog or cat, or in ImageNet, one of these 1,000 classes. So what you do, you cut off the last layer, you put a new layer on there, and then you only have to train the last layer, basically, which has just a few parameters. And that is much, much, much faster. So that's what we're going to do. Let's go. Our standard imports. Then Torch, our standard Torch imports, basically. We are going to use a GPU if we could. So we define our device variable. And then, I think the table of content might help here. So what do we do? It's always the same. It's a data model loss optimizer training loop for pretty much all your machine learning. Okay. So dogs and cats data set. Before I, like in the previous notebook, we had this transform. I'm just going to reuse it. And I have a slightly different transform for my validation data set, where I don't really augment the data by much. So I don't do any flippings, I don't do any color, jittering, whatever. So now I have my train transform and my validation transform. Then I'm going to import dogs and cats, because that's the data set we're going to use. We're going to create a train data set and a validation data set. Again, I'm just working with a sample because I don't have a GPU and it's too slow. And I pass the train transform to the train data set and the validation transform to the validation data set. And I'm just setting the batch size to 2 because then we see some iterations. Otherwise, it would just be done. This takes a little moment because it like reads all the files. Or like it loops over all the directories and stuff, like nothing is in memory yet, which is also nice. If you want to do this at home, here's the same thing for the full data set and the bigger batch size. We're not doing that here. So our train data set has 16, our validation data set has 8 samples. Very, very small. And then we're going to create 2 data loaders. The train data loader gets the train data set. We set a batch size, we set shuffle to 2, and we say 4 workers. Why not? And then we're going to do the same for the validation data loader. It gets the validation data set, batch size, shuffle false, 4 workers. Cool. Now we have our data. What do we need? We need the model, we need the loss, we need the optimizer. And I said we're going to do transfer learning, so we can use a pre-trained network. And PyTorch offers a bunch of pre-trained networks. For example, AlexNet, VGG, ResNet, SqueezeNet, DenseNet, Inception V3, and a bunch more, I think. And there are also like different projects on GitHub, which have even more. Like the NASNet is pretty new. NASNet is pretty new. ResNext, Inception, DPN, this is interesting. Whatever. We are going to use one of the smallest, or a very small one. We're going to use the ResNet 18 for our case. And we say pre-trained equals true. Suck. You can... You can set... I don't know. I think it automatically downloads it if you don't have it, which is nice. But now you have a network which can classify one of the 1,000 ImageNet classes with like a high accuracy, just like that. And I mean, pretty much all the libraries do that, right? Keras does it, TensorFlow does it, quite normal by now. If you just print the model, you see how it looks like. And this is a not that deep network, it's, you know? But it's quite a bit already. So. and we only have the ResNet 18. I think there's also the ResNet 200 something, like it gets deeper and deeper and deeper, right? But quite often the small ones are totally fine. The interesting part is it has this line. It has a fully connected linear layer in the end, which gets 512 input features and spits out 1,000 individual variables, which correspond to the ImageNet classes. But we only have two. So what do we do? First of all, we iterate over the model and set all the We set all the required grads to false. That means we wouldn't calculate the gradients for these. This means we wouldn't update them. Quite often, I do a lot of transfer learning, and I have like little helpers. For example, get trainable gives me all the parameters of model which do have gradients. So these are the trainable parameters. I have get frozen, which does exactly the opposite. I have all trainable, which gives me true or false. Are all parameters of the model trainable? Are all frozen? Are all models all parameters frozen? And I have a function freeze all. Which I use quite often. And here I'm just using this function, like freeze all model parameters and then make sure that all model parameters are frozen. There was a question. Yes, I can unfreeze whatever I want. Doesn't necessarily make sense. You would unfreeze the last one and the previous one. And you can start with the last one and train it a little bit and then turn down the learning rate a little bit, unfreeze a little bit more, and then like progressively iterate that. Or you could have different learning rates, like a high learning rate in the very end, and then lower and lower learning rate the earlier the features are, basically. Also possible. Good question. Okay, now I have this model and all the parameters are frozen. I can't learn anything. But I'll just replace the fully connected layer, which I showed you before, with a new one, a linear layer, 512 inputs, and I'm going to have two outputs for each class, or like two outputs in total, like dog and cat. I could also have one here, which is that zero would be dog, one would be cat or something, the other way around. I'm doing two here because it's more general. Okay, and I'm checking all frozen. No, not anymore, because a new layer is not frozen by default. Cool. I have this get model. This basically just creates me a model because I'm going to create models later. It's just a convenient function, which does exactly that, right? I get my ResNet model, I freeze it, I replace the last layer, and that's it. Cool. I have my model. Now I'm defining my loss, cross entropy loss in this case. I use my optimizer, and here I use this get trainable model parameters function. I only want to optimize the parameters which I can train, right? No point in optimizing the other ones. So, okay, now I have everything. I say I'm going to train for two epochs, and here this is a more full-fledged fit function or loop. I have like the for loop, somebody asked earlier, over the epochs, and then model train, here I iterate over my training data loader, I transform the data, I zero the gradients, I put the data through the model, I calculate the loss, I do the backward pass, call the optimizer, calculate some statistics. Details are not important, and especially given the time that I have, they're not important. And then I have like here pretty much the same just for the evaluation. So you see, the code doesn't matter. It's a bunch of code, and this is my least favorite thing about PyTorch, that you have to write this thing, right? If I run it, I get some output here, right? One epoch, validation accuracy of 25%. Chance will be better. I get like the loss per batch, I get the train loss, the train accuracy, validation loss, validation accuracy. The values don't really matter, the data set is way too small, but this is the logic, really. Yeah. And this doesn't make fun. This is not fun, right? Writing this every time. Like, I wrote this and I got it wrong. And I wasn't able to figure it out. Like, I've written so many train functions, train loops, and they're so simple, like, you don't really think about it. It's simple enough, but it's like difficult enough so that you make mistakes. And you always have to rewrite your statistics and whatnot. That's not really well integrated in PyTorch. That being said, now we have trained like our model, and this is work. This works for so many cases. This is quite nice. I'm just speeding up a little bit. There are... Okay, this was it, pretty much. But now you can do a bunch of things. There are some libraries which would help you to avoid writing these training libraries, these training loops. For example, there's Ignite, there's TNT, there's Scorch, or you should just, you know, write your own. Just do it. You learn something. Don't use it, but write it yourself, right? Just as a learning experience. For example, I'm going to show how this would look like with Ignite. It's a pretty new library. It was just released a few, or like it's on pip, or on the Python package index just a few days ago. And this offers you metrics, which is nice. And it also has these create supervised evaluator and create supervised trainer. And then it also has the concept of callbacks, which you can register so that on every epoch end, you do something. On every batch iteration, you do something. On every train, whatever, right? And then you pretty much do the same. You have, again, you define your model, same as before. You get your loss. You get your optimizer. And then you can create a supervised trainer where you pass in the model, the optimizer, and the loss. And you can create a supervised evaluator where you pass in the model, metrics that you want to calculate, and that's it. And then you can define these trainer on event iteration completed. You do something. So you have this callback mechanism which allows you to do certain operations, basically. And I'll just execute, and oops, sorry. Something is missing. Yes. And then you can just say run. And I didn't write the fit function here, like the training loop. This is already done by Ignite. I just did some stuff for printing out, and yeah, cool. And it works, voila. I see you, give me 5 more minutes, yeah? Who knows TensorBoard? So many hands, cool. No. How do I set the log deer? I thought I had it in my... Does any deer? Oh, okay. No. Oh well. Oh well. And I don't have internet to show it. That is too bad. So TensorBoard is this tool by Google which allows you to visualize your training and compare different models and whatnot. And there is TensorBoard X, which is like a PyTorch interface to TensorBoard. And that allows you to create a summary writer and then basically say summary writer at scalar and write your training loss or whatever, like any scalar to the summary writer, which will then write to the TensorBoard. And you can just use PyTorch with TensorBoard. And it's very easy to integrate that with Ignite. So here I'm doing that. My model. Here I have my training and my trainer and my evaluator. And in the callbacks that I defined, I just write whatever I'm interested in to the writer, and I'm done. And I can use all the TensorFlow goodness that I have. I can see my my training curves, I can see my graph visualization, I can have histograms of stuff. Like, pretty much all that stuff is also available by TensorFlow X. And I personally think the interface is nicer than the original TensorFlow interface. But that's just me. There's also another cool... So if you do this stuff, like, try out Ignite. It looks nice, I think. It's still, like, pretty early, but... Do it and use TensorBoard because it really gives you more insights about what's happening. Alternatively, there is Wisdom by the people from Facebook Research, which is like a big canvas of plots that you can have there and you can rearrange them. That also looks interesting. I haven't really used it yet, but I want to. Just summing it up. Yeah, so I hope you had fun. Here's a tweet. I don't have internet. Look at this. This gives you like the biggest errors people make when you do train neural network and stuff. Version 0.4 was just released, and it changed, like a few months by now, maybe. It changed quite a bit, I already said. The thing that's not so cool about PyTorch is it's not really like a production system yet. Like, it changes a bit, serialization is not there, TensorFlow serving is not there, and TensorFlow is much better there. But they really want to put the focus on productionization of PyTorch. So that's the real focus for the next 1.0 release. And they already integrated Caffe 2 in the PyTorch repository. Because, yeah, Facebook uses Caffe 2 as their main, or are going to use as their main production serving system. So a lot of stuff is going to happen there. Also, this Onyx, they're going to tweak Onyx a lot to export models. And they also have, like, a JIT compiler. And that's it. Yeah. And, yeah, if you're at home, like, look at the other ones. They're quite cool. Like, here's MeanShift clustering with TensorFlow, with PyTorch on the GPU. Teacher forcing is amazing. Yeah, there you have. Okay, we have to do this. there is a random number generator in the forward loop. What? So cool. Yeah, okay, that's it. Thanks.
We have only 5 minutes for the questions, so very short ones, please.
Then, in your opinion, when we should use PyTorch or when we should use other libraries, like Keras, for example?
If you just want to get something done, use Keras, I think, or use the high-level estimator API from TensorFlow. If you want to have fun, then use PyTorch. No, but like we use it at work. Like, this is what we... Oh, I didn't introduce myself. I'm Stefan, and I work at Druma. I told you... Yeah, we use PyTorch for our products. That works. Yeah.
Question? Here. So you mentioned production. Good. How do you do it? It's because, like, in your work, how do you put this into production? Because
I have all the code. I serialize the model. I load the model. I put it into a Docker container. I have a little REST interface, pretty much.
But you confirm that this is, I mean, this is absolutely impressive, but it's prototyping. It seems to be more easy prototyping. And that's
it is made for research and prototyping. I don't know, yeah. But you can do it. You can also use it in production. You don't get all this, like, goodness of TensorFlow serving, like automatic rollouts and A-B testing and all this stuff. That is not quite there yet. True.
And do we have a little bit more insight on this PyTorch 1.0 coming up?
There's a big blog post which goes into more detail, and I would just encourage you to read it.
Okay, perfect.
Thanks.
I've noticed on your GitHub there's actually less there's notebooks. Would you put like other notebooks that you put on this today into the GitHub later to read?
Say that again.
I've noticed on your GitHub there is only 3 notebooks, like IPython notebook, but today I kind of saw more.
Oh, sorry. If I forgot, I'll push all the stuff that I have. If not everything, I probably just forgot something. Sorry. Up there. I think.
Quite a simple question, I think. Do you happen to know a good implementation for an early stopping function?
PyTorch offers one. I didn't really like that one. I can't remember why. And I mean, I wrote my own little like high-level interface, so I have one. But I think Ignite also offers like a early stopping functionality. Or it's very easy to implement high-level methods like that with PyTorch. Also, Fast AI, this course and library, they have some tools like that. Yeah.
That's all the time we have. Thank you, everybody, and thank the speaker.